Our program today will be covering a variety of transportation programs at the City of Scottsdale that are designed for seniors as well as people with disabilities. We have a wide-ranging conversation today with our guests, covering not only regional planning for that addresses transportation issues, but also we have an advocate for the senior community that's worked on a coalition for a number of years, as well as our transportation manager, as well as she also covers transit operations. So we'll get started with Dee Dee Gestea, who is the human services planner, for MAG, which is the Maricopa Association of Governments. Then we have Jane Hubbard, who's done a variety of things. She's an advocate. She's been involved in the Age Friendly Coalition. She has been a member of a group that's at MAG that talks about human services. And then we have Lisa Johnson, as I mentioned. She is our manager of transportation and transportation and transit operations here at the City of Scottsdale. So we'll begin with some questions that I'd like to direct to Dee Dee, because she really is the person who's involved in the regional planning area. And I'd like to have you first explain a little bit about what MAG is and your role at MAG.
Okay, thank you. Well, the Maricopa Association of Governments is the designated metropolitan planning organization for the Maricopa region. And what basically that means is we're a venue where all the cities and towns, we have 23 cities and towns in the Maricopa region with three Native American communities, where we can come together and talk about issues that transcend cities' boundaries. We are a venue to talk about issues such as transportation, our air quality, and human services related issues. And and what we do is we do a lot of planning, planning on transportation. An example is sidewalks. You know, a sidewalk just doesn't end with the City of Scottsdale. It goes into Phoenix, it goes into the Native community. How do we plan on putting in a sidewalk that connects the cities? And at MAG, that's where we come together to talk about similar issues that transcends boundaries. And my role at MAG is I work with a population of older adults and persons with disabilities, and we talk about transportation issues. What are the gaps in the region, and also, and my, most importantly, what are the resources in the region? Where even though I have the title planner, I like to call myself a coordinator, where I depend on our stakeholders, such as those that are here today, elected officials, and the community to come together to talk about how we can overcome some of the issues regarding transportation, especially for those, the most vulnerable population of older adults and persons with disabilities.
So in what ways do you connect with and support Valley cities such as Scottsdale in helping to improve the transportation services that are provided to our seniors?
Well, at MAG, we have a wealth of information. We have a division where we can provide demographic information, employment information, to help cities plan and see where the gaps are and where we would need future planning to fill it. If there was an employer, how are the employees getting to deployment area? So MAG actually is the venue where we can all come together and talk together with the cities and provide them resources, technical assistance like such as studies. I staff the Human Services Coordination Transportation Plan to talk about strategies for older adults and persons with disabilities.
So it's important for everyone to understand that transportation programs don't just stop at city borders. They have to be planned across the entire region. And not only is it buses and other means of transportation, but it's also sidewalks and paths and trails and things that are going to connect cities together and improve our transportation network. Is that correct?
Definitely. At MAG, we're thinking multimodal. We're thinking of all alternative transportation options. We do have mobility. We do have pedestrian. We have bike, you know, alternative transportation options that will work with public transportation.
Yeah, and what programs have worked well, and maybe not so well. and then what can senior riders expect in the future from the various transportation programs?
Well, programs that have worked well is where different organizations work together. It's where you're actually providing a multiple resource of transportation alternative options that coincide with each other. And what has worked well is, the city of Phoenix had a program with Lyft to do that last mile of taking a consumer that is outside, close but not wasn't easily accessible to the bus line, to the bus line where they can take the bus line and continue to make their trip. So we're looking at different options to complete a trip. What has not worked well is that we need to market a lot of these alternative transportation options that are already in place.
Yes.
We know there is a lot of need for transportation, but there are not a lot of funding resources to fill those needs, so we have to look at other alternatives. How do we work with what's already in place to make that connection so we get our community to the places they need to go?
And how, explain to us how important this whole concept of transportation is for the senior population.
For the senior population is very important. There are different levels of seniors. There are those that are fit, that get up and get around and can make those connections. Then there's those that are fragile that may need a little bit of assistance to make that connection. And then those that are frail that want some sort resources that are more one-on-one.
Right.
So you need a multiple array of accessible transportation resources, because without these resources, individuals may not get out of their home. They may not get to the services such as medical, to the grocery store, but it also enhances the quality of life, which is very important. A multimodal community is a healthy community. It's an engaged community.
Yeah, I would agree with that wholeheartedly. So what happens when transportation is not available for seniors?
A lot of times they cannot get to the resources that they most desperately need. And if you can't get to the grocery store and eat healthy foods, then you're going to the doctors more often. And a lot of times, if you don't have transportation options, then that person just health kind of declines. So it all interconnects with each other.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Didi. You've really been able to provide a better understanding, I think, of what happens regionally in the transportation network. So we're going to move now to Jane Hubbard, who has been involved in advocating for the senior population for a number of years. She has served on our age-friendly coalition for 8 years now, I think. And she's also a human services commissioner here in the city of Scottsdale, and generally been an advocate for the senior community, as well as working with MAG on some programs there. So share with us your experience as an advocate for transportation services for seniors living in Scottsdale. Why is it important to you, and what is your experience in doing this?
You know, I can say it's become a passion through an interesting back door and a lot of work with Didi and Mag. I was a clergy person in North Scottsdale with a tiny church start, and someone tapped me on the shoulder and said, come work for the Foothills Caring Corps. And that's what brought me into transportation. And suddenly the door opened to this incredible need with a population who had no public transportation at all. They were older adults, I knew them, was getting to know them, who were literally homebound. And if it weren't for the Foothills Caring Corps providing some transportation, they were just getting off the ground, people would have had really no access to be able to get out and go places other than neighbors and Goodwill and a few taxi cabs.
Yes.
So that's how I got started. And it grew from one van to eight vans, from a tiny little program to now a large program. And I underscore what you said, Didi, about the issues when there is no transportation. That was clear to me. And I think I remember hearing this statistic early on from a federal speaker that studies show that to be socially isolated is the equivalent to smoking two packs of cigarettes a day. That's the standard. So it affects everything when people are isolated. And I would see them get on the vans and do utilitarian things, go to a grocery store, but more excited to go on the van and talk with neighbors and go out to lunch or go to a play or come down to the new Museum of the West and go to Randy's Diner and have a chance to get out. And I just became more and more convinced that transportation was sort of the meta basic of all human services. And that's how I met Mag and Dee Dee.
Yeah, because, explain some of your work with Mag.
Yeah,
what have you done there with Mag?
Oh my goodness. Probably 8 years coming to my first meeting, because we would apply for federal grants to receive the vans that we use, which the city of Scottsdale does as well. And then one of the grants was to become a mobility manager, which is an interesting term that simply means we're people tasked with coordinating municipalities, nonprofits all over the region, and working with Dee Dee, there were four of us, to make transportation happen for people. So we did consulting and training. But one thing I think we did that was wonderful was to reach out to all, both municipalities and mainly nonprofits, to find out what services were being provided. And we made a wonderful inventory that's on the MAG website. So somebody in Mesa could go in, or their relative, and look and see what transportation systems they could use. So it started to network. That was an important one. The trainings, we talk about frail seniors, of which the Foothills Caring Corps average age of a rider on our vans is 82. Most of them have walkers, wheelchairs. They're fragile to frail. And so they need a special encouragement. And we've helped to train people and think of ways that you can get these folks to feel safe and comfortable riding vehicles. So that's been a good initiative. And just encouraging other people getting started in alternative programs, as well as educate. We come together in TAP meetings, Transportation Ambassador Program, 4 times a year, and we share information. And that's how I met Ed Jones from the city of Scottsdale. And he was just starting Cab Connection. And Ed and I sat down at one of those meetings, and Ed didn't know we were providing transportation for folks in North Scottsdale. And one thing led to another, and your predecessor met with us, and we became part of Cab Connection, which is another great example of how we work together.
And it's an important program
that's
offered in North Scottsdale. There's another program that's available in South Scottsdale for residents to be able to be taken to doctor's offices.
Yeah. Duet, yes.
Duet is another program that does some transportation in the South. And so on the age-friendly coalition that started many years ago, transportation became a key part of the conversation there. And we found, as you explained, that this is the key to providing senior population as well as disabled people a way to be connected to their communities. So, you know, is mobility a concern for seniors? You talk to the seniors, what do they say about this? Is that their greatest concern, or are there others that are similar?
Well, I say it rises to the top 75% of the time. You can start talking about anything they want to do or in need, and pretty soon transportation is the barrier, more often than not, and Lisa knows this so well. So yes, it's a huge issue, and that's actually how Age Friendly started in Scottsdale.
Yeah.
With some wonderful empowered Scottsdale residents, and you and others who were champions, meeting at MAG offices, talking about how do we move people around, particularly North Central Scottsdale, where there wasn't any trolleys yet, although we just finally kicked off one, hallelujah, a new trolley route.
Yeah.
But that's sort of how it began, and then we became a part of a nationwide initiative for Age Friendly, of which MAG was the recipient of the grant money and oversaw. Scottsdale was one of 7 sites, and we joined with them and began working on all these issues of aging, of which transportation always remained, I would think, really an important piece. The group still meets. It's an incredibly successful piece of the age-friendly movement. I think Tempe, Scottsdale, and Surprise are the 3 groups that have remained solid for 8 years.
Yeah, Scottsdale's known as, I think, a premier city for servicing its senior population.
Yeah.
And that group, as I recall, when we first started it, we wanted to make sure we not only talked about internal city operations, but we brought in outside agencies to give us a better perspective. I think City did an inventory as well. Mm-hmm. You mentioned MAG did an inventory on the services available. And it was remarkable what we found that is available,
absolutely,
but kind of unknown. Not much is understood about the number of programs and services that are available. So Age-Friendly Coalition has really served a great purpose in getting the word out.
And in sharing best practices that go on in the city and meeting all the city folks that come and talk with us.
Yes.
And it helps us to give feedback and get feedback.
So from your perspective, what changes do you see coming in transportation, in services and programs for the seniors and the people with disabilities?
You know, transportation couldn't be changing more rapid fire, I would say, as long as our whole world with technology. And of course, we know all the buzz around autonomous vehicles and how that's changing things. But that's a slice of it. Because it really is happening now, and it's exciting because more people will have more accessibility who someday will have a vehicle that they can get in if they have vision issues or other issues and be able to still, that's a bit off, but even so, the technology is such in all ways that it's made services deliverable as well to people at home, older adults and persons with disabilities at home, which is a plus. You know, you can get blood draws now at home and lab work gets done and groceries get delivered. But it also brings the secondary issue of more social isolation, which is something the city will have to be aware of as those changes occur. How do we revamp our transportation thinking and our wonderful nonprofits to taking on a new role? Maybe I'm not driving them to the doctor's office, but I'm meeting them when the doctor comes to their house. So there's a lot of things that transportation will always feed into, but it's no question exciting. And here's another thing I thought of that came from Dee Dee, a conference she attended that I think is brilliant. We, as a region area, are number one for pedestrian deaths in the nation, which isn't anything we ever want to advertise or be proud of. What a terrible situation. Living downtown Scottsdale, I see, you know, we have bikes and scooters and people and pedestrians and cars and traffic, and I'm constantly aware. And there's an initiative, and I'm going to let Dee Dee talk about it, that she heard about having smart stoplights.
Oh.
Can you speak to that?
Okay. That's
great. I think it's fascinating.
Good. I didn't know that. What is that?
Well, I'm not sure if you heard of or have seen this, the hog stoplights.
Yes,
where
I have.
It makes an audible sound. But there are there are smart pedestrian crossways where at mid-block, instead of having a crosswalk at an intersection, they have it at a midsection where it stops traffic just for that pedestrian to cross the road. And we know a lot of times there are pedestrian accidents when people are crossing mid-block.
Yes.
So there are these crosswalks that, and there's several different designs. There are crosswalks that have really bold markings at midsection, and they have a rest area where you stop in the middle and then to complete your crossing. There are also these signals that, just stop traffic for the pedestrian in order to safely cross the road and then gets the flow of traffic going again.
Yeah, well, this is great.
Isn't it amazing?
I'm glad that we are looking at that. I know there's a few in Scottsdale and there's probably need for more. Mm-hmm. We get requests from people from time to time to take a look at that in their neighborhood. So I'm glad we're taking a look at that, how this can be implemented in Scottsdale. So we're gonna move on to Lisa Johnson, who has a big responsibility for making sure that all this stuff works in Scottsdale, that we have transportation programs that work, and we have buses that run, and we can put in trolleys and all the things that are available. So my first question would be, describe to all of us the various travel options that are available to seniors and people with disability in Scottsdale at least a number of them. You may not be able to cover everything because there's a lot.
Right, and thankfully there is a large amount of options. I'll start first with the trolley, which is probably our most visible transportation option here in the city of Scottsdale. And the trolleys run now, thank you, Jane, for reminding me that in October of last year, we expanded our trolley service. So it goes all the way to Hayden and Northsite up in that shopping area there, as well as serving the Mustang Library and the Via Linda Senior Center. Prior to that, it served just the Granite Reef Senior Center. So we've made a connection now between those two. One of the things that people don't know about the trolley, and I don't know how they miss it, is the trolley is free. It is free to everybody. There is no charge for the Scottsdale trolley, and it runs every 20 minutes on all four routes. The downtown trolley actually runs every 15 minutes, a little more frequent service there. One of our best transportation options for seniors in the city of Scottsdale is our Cab Connection program. And that is a program that provides subsidy through vouchers for people using taxis to complete their travel. The issue is there is no income requirement or minimum on that, which shocks a lot of people. The requirements are that you have to be 65 and older or ADA certified. And the benefit to being ADA certified is that actually opens up a couple other travel options to you that I can cover in just a minute. But we currently have over 1,400 participants in Cab Connection, and I definitely know there are more than 1,400 people in the city of Scottsdale that are over 65. And you do not have to be homebound. You can have a driver's license, and each household gets 16 vouchers per eligible adult. So a couple that's 65 or older, that leaves 32 vouchers.
Is that per month?
That is per month, yeah. Yes, thank you. And then we also have a program through Cab Connection for those who have frequent medical needs like dialysis, and we also have a program through Cab Connection that brings people to the Granite Reef Senior Center for lunches from their home. And then we do have our PATH system. I thought it was great that you mentioned. We have a lot of active seniors, and so we have paths throughout the city of Scottsdale, and the city's goal is to have a walking path within a half a mile of every residence in the city of Scottsdale. And ironically, our goal for public transit is to also have public transit availability within at least a half mile of every household in the city of Scottsdale.
Yeah. These are all great programs that are available for seniors, and I wonder if you could tell me what priorities you have right now for planning services for in the future. Like, for example, I believe I don't know if this is going to serve seniors so much, but there will be a neighborhood circulator in the Air Park area that's being planned for later. What other things might be coming down the pike that could be programs available for seniors?
Right. Most of the programs that we exist will be enhancing. And so, for example, we talked about the trolley improvements, and our priority with the trolley is really threefold. It is convenience and reliability, accessibility, and equitability. So right now we're running 20-minute service. We would prefer to increase that service so that people who don't have to use public transit, as a stigma that's associated with public transit is that only people who don't own cars will use public transit. And we want people to understand you can have a car. We want you to ride because it's convenient. You can do your own thing while you're on the trolley, text message, emails, listen to books, read books, and reduce the reduce the emissions and improve the air quality. And so that is really important to us. We will also be putting technology onto our trolleys. It's called onboard technologies. There's a whole suite of options with that, but what affects the customers and our seniors in particular is that there will be onboard announcements about what upcoming bus stops and intersections. That will help people with disabilities who are visually impaired. Right now that is done by the trolley operator, but the operator can be hard to hear at times, or there's a lot of commotion on the bus and it makes it kind of difficult for people to hear. As far as accessibility goes, we currently already are fully accessible on all of our trolley vehicles. For those who don't use the trolley, if you're in a mobility device or utilize a walker, you can request a ramp, and the ramp comes down off of the trolley and it negates the need to step up. And so you don't have to have a mobility device, you just have to request that the operator deploy that ramp. Then with our Cab Connection program, we always are looking to expand it. We are also, as mentioned, Cab Connection serves north and central Scottsdale areas where there may not be frequent public transit. And there is a valley-wide program called Ride Choice that the City of Scottsdale is entertaining joining so that our citizens here have even more travel options. Ride Choice allows a little bit longer ride, a little more subsidy, so a little more affordable for the user of Ride Choice, and it also involves rideshare Lyft. And the user can still determine if they'd rather take a taxi or use Lyft, but it's my understanding that Lyft has been very successful in picking people up within 4 to 5 minutes of their request. Yeah. So we're really looking forward to that.
There's just so many things available. I know that this can be a little overwhelming to people listening to this about all the things that are available. And so I appreciate the fact that you're looking at like Ride Choice and other programs that might be utilized in other parts of the city and trying to incorporate those into Scottsdale. Yeah. But you've mentioned the trolley several times. You and I both rode the trolley when it first started, and I think it's a wonderful program available to people. It's going close to my neighborhood, the new trolley that goes between the Granite Reef Senior Center and the Via Linda Senior Center. And it the trolley goes up to the corner of Frank Lloyd Wright and Via Linda, which is near where I live. And so people ask me, what is that trolley sitting there for? And they don't understand first that it's free, and they don't understand where it goes. So we need to make sure that they do. How do we get the word out to people that this is something that was added for them to use and not to be afraid of it, get on it and just ride it. You can ride it all the way around and come back and get off, and then you understand the route. So how do we get the word out?
Right, so the City of Scottsdale currently, with these new changes, understands that we need a marketing plan, and we do have some ideas for marketing within the communities there. Obviously, Via Linda Senior Center and Granite Reef Senior Center have received quite a bit of marketing. But there are a lot of HOAs and communities right along these routes and businesses that we feel we need to educate and get postings out so that they can bring this forward to their residents and employees. However, the best advertisement is always going to be word of mouth. So people watching this program, if you use Cab Connection, if you use the trolley, if you use Valley Metro or Ride Choice, make sure you tell people how great it is, because an offer to go with them or set up lunches where you can try an alternate type of transportation. And I think that is really going to be the best way to market it, but we do currently have a plan for reaching that area.
Yeah, well, thank you so much, Lisa. I'm glad you explained all that to us. If there are questions, and there probably are because we've kind of zoomed through a lot of programs available, you can go to scottsdaleaz.gov and type in the search section transportation services, and a lot of these programs will be explained. So this is a great resource for you to go to the city website and better understand the transportation programs. And I very much appreciate the interest that all of us and the viewers have in transportation, and I hope you've been able to view some of our previous programs on the senior centers and activities for seniors. Our age-friendly coalition also participates and presents a number of events through the year that talk about senior services that are available, transportation, and otherwise. You can also, besides going to the website, stop by one of the senior centers. The Granite Reef Senior Center is at Granite Reef and McDowell, and you can pick up the Scottsdale Quarterly publication that explains senior programs, or you can go by the Via Linda Senior Center and pick up the publication there. Via Linda Center is on Via Linda, a few blocks south of Shea Boulevard. So there's available information that we would like for you to be able to put into your hands, and we hope you will do that. Our next program that we will be discussing here with a number of guests will be to talk about how Scottsdale in particular assists seniors with housing needs. And this obviously is another big issue. It's one that is difficult to tackle, but we hope that we can do that in another program. So stay tuned, and thank you so much for joining us today.